Good morning. It's a great pleasure and thank you for being in such a community, being invited to have this first word of keynote or how to speak. What was announced as a lecture for this keynote speech was basically four parts of the history that I will a bit in a jazzy way mix up and come to all of this and take some particular parts of each of those, as probably you've seen, proposed eras from European history or music history, for the simple reason that these are also social and political so strong moments of history that they have impacts on the music, and that we as the jazz community, or better to say jazz and beyond community, can learn a lot from such a lessons in a very old inclusive manner, when we can approach and learn something also from the other parts of music. In that case, it will be partly also classical music and connections with some productive moments that can we learn from. I prepared some moments, and I will start with nowadays. I will go a bit into terminology, as this lecture has been called Innovative Music in Europe. So I will a bit also polemicize with these terms, go briefly through the history, suggest something, and see some struggles in the recent years, or better to say in the recent decades, what was going on that came into this proposal as innovative music, beside all the other propositions that were made through last 30, 40, or even more, 50 years of discussing what is the possibility to go jazz and beyond, while organizing, while talking about, while producing, while distributing, etc., etc. For this reason, I prepared kind of more, let's say, philosophical introduction into it, and then I will go into some special cases, discuss something, and certain things will for sure be left for the next round table that goes into shaping, or what is said here, developing the audience for such musics we are interested in. And as I see from the title, Innovative Music, it's quite open-minded community that can accept also all this polemic stuff and other things that are necessary to understand better how and where to move on from this very special, again, very special social and political moment, as there were so many in the history. I will take some stories and some special cases from. Speaking about terminology briefly, as I said, I find in a way innovative music sympathetic, on the other hand also problematic for talking about, but in a way it's very productive, because saying, naming things like this always leaves some other space for the new, some improved approaches into shaping this our very special position, how to attract more people, how to behave within all those musics and approaches, and last but not least, how to attract more audience, and being in a way happy with all the things we are all doing in this special community. A so-called jazz community was always very, very special in the history. When I mentioned that we will learn from certain epochs, from certain historical, social, political moments, on the other hand, we can also turn the story and saying that learning from the jazz history is one of the best possible learning of the history that we cannot take from many, many other musics that are more shaped, that they don't have so provocative, so rich and so diverse historical approach and also some historical meanings. For the innovative music, for sure, we need some innovative environment. Innovative environment is something that is quite difficult to reach today because of the special reasons I will mention when I will go now briefly through crucial moments of nowadays, beside all technologies, digitalization, lots of information, and I will quote, beside our psychologist Dušan Rutar, I will quote somebody I quote very rare, but when we are in Ljubljana, Slavoj Žižek will appear briefly when shaping this moment when we are searching or questioning what could be and what should be innovative nowadays, in the contrary of something that is non-innovative, that goes on as perpetual tradition, what is so familiar, and we are familiar with what is going on nowadays, when more or less goods and commodities and everything is sold and without questioning, and the answers are as we have the very as we may observe that this is something that is every day on our table, and that we live in the world where common people or the agenda, the trend is that nothing is questioned, that everything is already done, that we live in some perpetual present, that we are not asking ourselves nevermore why, but it's constant on our table, why not, and everything goes, etc., what all terms appear, not only in our general lives, but also in music, that has been always the field, like jazz history could be example of approaching history in general. This kind of appearance in music is also crucial, that we can make observation to the something that is more holistic in our lives. Speaking about terminology, as I said, could be problematic, and if I look it through maybe somehow more narrow point of view, that's the point of view of improvised music, and when we celebrate 50 years of radio student in Ljubljana, I can remember some terms, some terminology that was going on and that could be connected with nowadays innovative music, with this proposed innovative music, despite, of course, take observation that this will be from much, much more special field, which is somehow inside this innovative music proposal. I remember end of the 70s when the radio proposed such kind of things that they were speaking, now I'm quoting, about music of the creatives. This music of the creatives was somehow bringing to the broadcast not only improvised music, but also something that is called electroacoustic music and other fields from the so-called contemporary classical music, or how we may call it. So this was the term that went until the beginning of the 80s, when it was constructed, and it lasted quite long. So-called contemporary improvised musics, which is a term we can discuss a lot. When I talked with my colleague Icho Widmar recently, he remembered his interview with Peter Brutzmann in 1984, when he mentioned this kind of expression that was quite common in our broadcasting radio student system. He was not very satisfied with the term contemporary, and his answer was, "I always hated Karlheinz Stockhausen." So this kind of contemporary improvised music was somehow too closely connected into with the classical system that was at that time very, very different from the fields of freely improvised approaches or European free jazz. So later on, it was, it's still nowadays under the influence of Derek Bailey, more or less is used nowadays freely, or free musics, let's say improvised. On the other hand, there are two other expressions going around and being regularly in our media and also broadcasted. That is radical. Of course, radical is always around, or maybe unbound. Unbound is maybe the expression I like most, until this innovative, which is part of what we, in at least here in Slovenia, call nova musica, new music, as a special expression, where this innovative music with lots of other packages, with approaches into music that involve creativity in special sense, or some special appearance, or some special approaches into old known forms, can make this kind of package where jazz, improvised music, some special way of approach to the old and contemporary classical stuff, some parody, also some waves that were out of the shape, what is quite good described in the research of mentioned Icho Widmar in about the new music in New York. If we, for instance, we all basically know what Bagatelles of John Zorn are, if we take the whole appearance of all those lineups and bands being within, going from metal, grindcore, to string quartet, to solo piano, to classical jazz band, this can all shape some kind of new music that was termed in comparison, or as the contrast, the counter of the contemporary classical music with its special socio-political and also, let's say, class establishment that we may observe beside contemporary classical nowadays also in the sound art, which can be also discussed now or later on as quite interesting, if not problematic, because it establishes basically on some level same approaches as they are in innovative music in general, but regarding it more arty, taking approach out of the musicianship, and with this act stressing more and more that musicianship, or things we are we are in the business for and with are more or less entertainment. And this entertainment has a strong pressure, so more arty approaches are, on the other hand, more those open. We are all, I believe, involved. So from this music of the creatives, via more freely innovative, radical, unbound musics, we can discuss more and more, and I'm sure that it will be still opportunity on the round tables and around to discuss it more and more. It's not so problematic, but as we are a lively community, it's always nice to discuss it and to suggest some add, to compare it with other things, or even to establish some special diversity, which is also, as before mentioned, Slavoj Žižek once put that on the very paradoxical way, nowadays state of capitalism via its individuality, this is very risky thesis, but on the other hand, understandable, that capitalism creates space for more differences. Among them could be also innovative music, even for one more appropriate order of hierarchy, because we all know that nowadays hierarchies are more or less impossible, nonsense, rotten, they are somehow in the decline. So in all this environment that seems nowadays unequal, hopefully one day will provide enough space for more diversities, and communities like this are of course a perfect example of how is it possible in such heavy, such turbulent times to establish something new. Inequality plus different competencies, and these competencies are for sure something that should be discussed. For the conclusion of this first part, I will just mention titles and remind you on the first six albums of Ornette Coleman, when this approach into searching, into finding something else, into finding some innovative title, what was actually going on from 1958 until 1961, it's nice to remind them and to think about in stressing what was discussed a bit before. So we remember that first album of Ornette was called Something Else with 5 exclamation marks, 58. Next year there appear 3 albums, Tomorrow is the Question, The Shape of Jazz to Come, and already then, end of the 50s, Change of the Century, with a more strict statement, beginning of the 60s, This is Our Music, Free Jazz, the famous album from the year 60, and then simply by the name Ornette, 1961. So 6 albums were searching, and then coming again from 5 exclamation marks until the name itself with one exclamation mark. So through this we can repeat once again how the history of jazz in the narrower term, when it's expanding, it's always searching, and it's always nice beside looking at the historical pictures and photographs on the shape of the recording machinery of the LPs that appeared. It's always nice to follow not only the titles, but also the titles of the LPs and albums themselves. Namely, they say a lot, and they are some nice works questioning and reproducing and giving into public titles and their meanings. Of course, everything this, and we must stress also when we will move in 10 minutes slowly into more history, that we are, of course, discussing something that is in European history quite secondary. It's not on the first level as visual culture always was. We are namely talking about music production, about listening, that was always, and the history of musicology shows us in the last 40 years very, very good how this listening cultures, hearing cultures, and the whole auditive cultures are always secondary in comparison how the visual culture is represented in culture itself. If we are aware, this I will stress again, and saying that this is very basic when we go deeply into history, if we are aware that we are part of distribution, as Ičo Vidmar stresses quite well, and not the part of the production of the music, we are able and we are more fruitful in starting thinking not only about music, but thinking music themselves. On this level, among nowadays problems, I would add that the problem of nowadays cultural politics is many, many times that some part of the music that is certainly distribution, as presenting is, as journalism is, are set into the shape of production. What could be problematic, and it's another topic to be discussed about now only briefly, for sure somebody who is presenting in the strict sense is not a music producer, as cultural politics, at least in this country, evolved as the profession. It's better to say music distributor, and if we go in the very, very classical Marxist way, it's establishing this balance, which is, of course, disturbed when all parties are on the sphere of production, and distribution is reserved only for the magazines, distribution is reserved only for records, etc. I strongly agree that broadcasting and music presenting should be and could be on the side of distribution, and that it's nothing wrong. And of course, in the on the small scale, we are part of producing something, producing the event, etc. But as the part of the cultural industry, distributional part should be more stressed in order to have the balance and in order to have innovative principles as such that we could be happy with. I promised one more Žižek observation to conclude briefly with the problems of nowadays, not only terminological, but we see that still persistence of visual culture, that the eye and ear are of course heavily bombed on all the sides, but via media, visualization is still so present that this secondary position stays pretty the same as it was, despite all the scholars, despite all the studies that were done on that theme. But maybe it's not that bad, because position from this side in culture can be additionally productive, as the immanent dynamics of capitalist society, what Žižek stated, and I think this was the best, the most productive part of his dispute with Jordan Peterson, the turn towards culture this very dangerous moment that we appear, that capitalists turn towards culture as the key component of capitalist reproduction, and not only this, commodification of cultural life itself, are the crucial moments of capitalist extended reproduction. For decades, we know that culture itself is one of the most beautiful parts of our lives, but on the other hand, in the strict socio-political environment, it's very dangerous tool, as we very well learn from Icho's book mentioned before, observing New York and the last decades. We observe quite clearly how the culture, how the cultural field was also strong, if not sometimes strongest part of gentrification of something that was moving, ruining things, and unconsciously helped culture industries to go into the position that nowadays culture really is one of the most obsessive parts of contemporary capitalism, that this capitalism itself, with the help of culture on all different levels, from migration politics to looking at the minorities, to surveillance, to everything, cultural tourism, that all this package are leaving on one hand not so much space for our activities, but being in communities like this, it's always possible to shape something very special that hopefully such community as this is can produce something fruitful on. When we mentioned invention, and this invention is the theme of the lecture, I will, with the help of mentioned psychologist Dušan Rutar, briefly see what is actually going on without this strict Marxist remarks, as Žižek said, but I think, on the other hand, are very crucial, because they are leaving, on one hand, not so much space, on the other hand, quite a lot by total individualization and by shaping new communities, re-questioning old terms as jazz it, and going through inventions to the position when one observes that also reinvention appears. Reinvention in comparison with invention means inventing something once again. And as Rutar observes, people are able to invent once more, and it's nothing bad. If I go again to jazz history, we have beautiful examples of how groups of nowadays are reinventing, for instance, Jelly Roll Morton, but not reinventing, or individuals reinventing in the way that they are revivalists, what we are all skeptical about, hopefully, but reinventing in a way that is showing that this music was inventing once before, to show the inventness for the decades, for the one century ago, to reinvent something what is closely connected with love, as Rutar said, and I strongly agree. It could be love in our everyday life, our intimate life, and also love with music. So people are able to invent once more many things, once again, what has already once been invented by our ancestors. And it seems like a paradox, how to invent something that has already been invented, but it's actually quite simple. Basically, the question is how to create conditions for the new understanding, for instance, of love. How to go into new intersubjective, interpersonal relationships. and to stress even more strongly how to change something that nowadays in digital era is more and more problematic not only for the reasons of digital era and lots of information, but also because of the things I mentioned briefly before. That means that globally social, or let's say social productive relations, are more or less destroyed. They need to be re-established, reinvented again. So love, as our love for music is, our love for innovative music is, represent itself in a totally new way, creating some new effects. It's certainly not yet a social revolution, but means for sure revolution in the life of those who are part of such reinvention. It doesn't represent the old world, so the representative of the old might like to demolish it. Even in the case of intimate love, we all know from our lives that many, many times people are trying to attack this reinvention. And this violence upon the new, upon innovative, is certainly not a surprise, as the new connects people in a new, quite unpredictable way. And people's connection surely has social dimensions, because it means a trip through social fields that have influence on many, many people and offer themselves as a novum, as something that they are not used to. Or better to say, and in many cases it's like this, people are no more used to such things. Such a trip, such a travel into reinvention is an opening realistic way, and also opening in realistic way. We must, of course, not be naive, thinking that such an opening of the reality is always welcome, as already said. Basically, and in many, many cases, people who are searching novum, who are searching for new relationships, for the new social productive relations, are not welcome, as we said, in reinvention of love, for instance. It seems that we all live in a world where there is no more questioning about the new. Nowadays, promises more or less the same, more and more of the same. So this this amount of this sameness, of these same things, was briefly observed when I was on, probably it was the indie, so-called indie rock concert, and I asked my friend, who is freely improvised musicians, why people are so euphoric when nothing is going on stage. And he said that I don't understand nowadays that it's better, that now for certain part of youngsters is better than nothing is going on, that they somehow enjoy that the working process, the social productive process is not going on stage, and less is going on, better it is. So it's somehow connected with this observation that more of the same appears, more data, more facts, more commodities, more dead things, stressing that we are dealing with more or less dead capital. What is going on is more or less dead capital. More robots, more surveillance cameras, more collecting the data about people's habits, about people's lifestyles, more and more of almost everything that is blocking approaching to the new and accept not only inventive things, but innovative things, but also accepting, not accepting, reinvention of things. What means relaxation? And you'll see our main ideology, what is mentioned before, and this relaxation, when we observe in this relaxed, commodified life, to repeat again, are the questions why not? As one observes, people are more or less using expression why not instead of asking themselves why. One observes, on the other hand, more and more monocultures being set into eternal present with this feeling, for instance, that 90s are still going on and on, with the approach anything goes. And of course, this is closely connected in music sense with this very, very special and out of the fear satisfaction with genres, and even not with only this, with disintegration in music itself, as we will see a bit later, is a quite interesting historical process in music. There is a spontaneous fear of the new, innovatives nowadays. If the new doesn't mean more and more, or new variations of the same, new cars, for instance, variations of the same as new tools, new services, new smart machines, etc. With these new things, there are basically no problems. Problems are with the other things we are busy with. These are not, of course, the forms of the new. New may be ideas because of which something that seemed impossible yesterday is all of a sudden totally possible. What is for sure not a revolution in the strict sense, as mythology of the history sells us, but it's a revolution of the mind, revolution of the spirit in the symbolic field, which could be closely connected with the nature of the new social relations, of the nature of love, as mentioned before, with one special condition, that this kind of happily approach into new fields, into innovatives, are maybe connected with one statement, very good, once written by Bertolt Brecht, saying that it should be a goal in life to find something. We are afraid more of the dead, and this is the fear of the unpleasant, of impossible life. So if we are aware that there are fears in our realistic, in our productive lives, in our ambition to innovativeness, is stronger, that this fear of impossibility of the moment is stronger than fear of death, then it means also innovativeness in the life. Such a difference in approaches, so blocking new and ambition of having new things, is of extreme importance, as the revolution in the mind means particularly a new type of questioning the world, of questioning the positions about the world, questioning about the world and about what we may have in common, what is all connected strongly with what will be more said on the round table about shaping the audience. So offering such a question of innovativeness to other people as the first step, must it really everything be like promises of politicians used to be before elections, or how people mind can be changed, how their beliefs can be changed with this kind of small reinventing of things, how their guards and excuses, despite their completely irrational, could be quite rational and quite realistic ones. As your older colleague and late great social historian Eric Hobsbawm, also jazz critic said once when he was criticizing at the end of his autobiography one of those approaches to nowadays and mentioned before, this why not, eternal, present, and etc. He was critical with a statement saying, well, things are like this, we cannot help, we must accept them like this. Of course, as the materialist thinker, he strongly and immediately answered that it could be something completely different. The world is possible to be thought in a way that it's something completely different. So such questioning, well, questioning about reinvention already means opening of the reality that is a kind of non-violent revolution. It means opening that never closes, because these are not the questions that could be answered like in the school in front of the blackboard in order to receive the highest possible mark. Such a questioning is unfortunately quite successfully suppressed by the ideology in a shape of offered ideas, as I mentioned them before, that represent answer to the questions. And this is one of the strongest ideologies going on today. For sure, as they are shaping our lives and that we live in nowadays, are much more dangerous as battles on the ideology of the old thing, for instance, equilibration of totalitarianisms, etc., etc. While this kind of ideology, suppression, all searching of the new by the others is much, much more dangerous. These are predicted questions, so it seems that their answers are predicted as well. And when everything is known in advance, there is the end. However chaotic such a life is, or could be, it becomes pointless and represents by a straight, totally linear line. And if we observe such approach of the people who are suppressing innovative, suppressing new, and this is unfortunately majority of population, when we observe this linear line that asks us, that waits for us on every corner, we can briefly transform it into our approach to music and to observe and to think music from this field, from this very position. Now we will slowly move into four crucial moments of European inventiveness. I positioned in the proposal for this speech. Of course, I could add some other things, for instance, for the history, that are also very crucial for thinking the innovative music, such, for instance, polyphonics, or invention of temperature in European history, but also because of the lack of time, we go more into the moments that were politically and socially strong and influenced in the last 250 years. While this adding, I will briefly finish adding polyphonics, I suggest reading a very good survey about musical life in a changing society, written by the late Viennese musicologist and sociologist of music, Kurt Blaukopf, from his Aspects of Musical Sociology, when there are beautiful chapters showing how parallel inventions of polyphonics and inventions of linear perspective in the Renaissance painting are totally artificial processes, that they were invented in a way that we didn't expect it, and that mind is always trying to believe that there were some kind of historical natural processes on a certain point, what was not true. To these two more moments, of course, in the European community through the centuries, we could add also very, very special church, in this sense, especially Catholic politics, towards dance, towards using some instruments in the environment of the holy places, but not only this, controlling use of dance, singing and instruments in other fields. So I choose four moments. One, the moment of nowadays, was briefly discussed as the beginning, that were also politically strong. And not only this three, now we have three historical moments, they offered in one way dreams, and on the other hand, we may observe catastrophic moment when these dreams didn't come true, that they were not fully fulfilled, but as we know from the history, from these failures, of course, we don't learn a lot, but on the other hand, history itself is learning and inventing new and new tools how the new catastrophes are appearing in the certain positions later and later on. With these dreams, especially that I will mention, it's not easy to move in the strict social aspect of music, in the aspect that it's one of the reasons we are all sitting here as well. And it's never enough to stress that so-called jazz community should know general historical moves in music, because jazz always has been and still is the most of all the music, one that is involving, that it's inclusive, and beside the strong crack that appears when it was once part of popular music and then all of a sudden became not more part of so popular music, it all shapes kind of very, very special field when we may observe this historical moments in a very, very special ways. And history of jazz in its many interpretations is, of course, quite school example. It's also necessary to stress again of how to observe history in its very materialistic shape. We may namely learn a lot from the history of jazz itself for the reasons that were mentioned and for the reasons that can be discussed in some other occasion also. I'm sure that on the round tables or in the corners of this community here. The first moment I proposed is a French Revolution for the very simple reason because it's connected and nowadays it's quite understandable with obsession of technology what was basically going on, especially in those 25 years before Restoration in France, and it meant really a lot. In 1989, when it was bicentenary, when it was 200 years of the French Revolution, of the revolution that nowadays in this status of capitalism is under question, and it's more and more under question with the appearance of alt-right, and we can observe it in the war between so-called alt-right and cultural Marxism, etc. when they were celebrating 200 years, and it's not so difficult for France, because France can easily lead its archives for centuries, going into 14th, 13th century, it was not that difficult to produce with the sources of Republic lots of studies. And I remember particular studies about music. More, they were obsessed with the songs of the revolution, but there were also very, very good archival data about the total new approach about view on the instruments. Together with the appearance of the new bourgeois society and appearance of the so-called free citizenships and being ambivalent towards the church, all of a sudden in these 25 years, through all the revolution and Napoleon, we may observe very much interest and total changement in view on the instrument that is crucial till nowadays. What does that mean? That means that in comparison with the piano and with the strings that were reserved for aristocracy before, in comparison to sporadic appearance of instruments on the street, French archives offered us a lot of data, a lot of statistics about increase of interest and encouraging to learn brass instruments, to learn woodwinds, to learn percussion, all this for the louder and louder expression of the Holy Ghost of the revolution and shaping the acoustic picture that is much different than one before, that was more and more intimate. The numbers of increasing of interest and opening public schools is also connected with the techniques and with the craftsmanship while inventing, while making these instruments better and better, and especially in that period we may see the very beginning of the techniques that are still used, especially if I mention woodwinds and brass, invention of the piston, mechanics on clarinet, oboe, flute, etc., etc., putting them in the shape that they are still in value nowadays. When I mentioned craftsmanship, craft, instrument making, it's nice to observe, and it's a kind of even tragicomical anecdote on the level of Europe, that still nowadays, when I mentioned clarinet, we see totally different mechanics on the French part of the school system and mechanics of the instrument and the German one. This is interesting, as I stressed, music field on many, many levels and in many, many shapes is the best possible tool to observe not only history, but also such details as in unique Europe can show us a lot what is going on through 200 years that people are using total different mechanics in approaching of one instrument, thinking what does that mean, why is it not unified, why certain things in Europe are under directives, are unified, but things like this simply remain the same and are part of the culture, somewhere hidden in their differences, waiting for the new and new opportunity. This wave of one quarter of the century of inventing new instrument, of new interests, on growing the orchestras, on totally new acoustic space in Europe, possibly after Renaissance, the best example of the new acoustic space in connection with political environment and social environment, This wave, of course, made also the possibilities of the first public concerts and later on in the Austrian and German field about shaping the professionalism in music. Well, first public concert, as we may observe, on the court of Esterhazy when Joseph Haydn was working, is also one of these waves of the revolution in the 90s of 18th century, end of the 90s. It was already possible for Joseph Haydn to convince his master to repeat concerts that were organized firstly for the aristocracy and at the same in the same shape with the open door next day opened for the so-called common people, for the audience that came. And I'm strongly convinced that beside invention in the orchestras and all this Viennese classics composition, the third component, and very, very important in sociology of music, is public performance that appeared end of the 19th of 18th century and opened the way for professionalization, opened the way for using these instruments mentioned before to being played professionally and to be also employed as the professional musician or composer later on. So this, as I showed, this invention and the whole craft, the whole technique, the obsession with the new mechanics is of course closely connected with nowadays obsession of technology. When innovative principles are in some narrow-minded way, if you browse, and I browsed innovative music, and I saw before preparing this lecture that majority of innovative music is connected with electrophonics. So innovative music is not in the first results while browsing positioned in a more general music way, in the approach that respects community, searching for new examples in jazz music, in this case in general, going beyond, but is more or less reserved as the term of innovative in electrophonics. I use term electrophonics as it was proposed by Nick Shagligo in Zagreb once in his dictionary of avant-garde musical terms. So like we use multiphonics, polyphonics, we use, and I like this use, electrophonics as the instrumental and other approach. The second moment I proposed is of course moved more than one century towards nowadays. This second position is very, very special because after the turbulent years of French Revolution, after all the restorations and other revolutions, communes, the whole invention of materialistic science, of scientific socialism, the birth of the materialistic dialectics, the position of the class consciousness is marking 19th century so strongly that we can speak about, in a way, frustrative, but on the other hand, very, very fruitful and important moment after First World War, and let's say towards the Nazism in Germany, towards the Second World War, in the case of Soviet Union, these approaches, these results of all these struggles and all these movements, when the whole workers' movement was firstly strong in France and then established very, very strong movement in Germany, especially Germany, and made possible Soviet Revolution in 1917. This pool of ideas and of music inventions in different fields is also very important for us. We can use several composers' examples. We can go, while observing this, into education, and why not to do this? Especially in Germany, end of the 19th century, education in general, also music education, thinking about it, in certain fields on the left, in the workers' movement, was so strongly established before the disaster of the First World War, before the social democracy, the SPD, betrayed workers' class. The education was so strongly established that it was not that difficult to continue after First World War, going on with basically same position, and of course with so many tragical results, especially in Germany, but on the other hand also with another results in the case of Soviet Union with successful revolution. The SPD namely strongly supported education in general from kindergarten to the schools on, and all this from the 90s of the 19th century until, let's say, 1914, was very possible platform to have different approaches, to open minds for moves that were becoming realistic in the 20s especially, and in some parts also in the 30s. If we look at the particular personal ideas, and we all know the revolutionary composer Arnold Schoenberg, it was possible to him, well, this is Austrian environment, but in the 1911, when the school system, education of the workers' movement was so strongly established also on the faculty level, on the new university level, the connection between revolution in the arts, well, don't be naive that revolution in the arts means also revolution in realistic, in political life, but the open-mindedness and the whole environment in Vienna before the First World War was possible to find a job even for the guy that was impossible to employ. So they invented Arnold Schoenberg, the position of the conductor of the workers' choirs, and this helped him a lot while being in revolutionary process that lasted from beginning of the 20th century to the in the first part to the First World War. This is not just like unique example, as the whole package of thinking on revolution in the process of music was also possible later, as I said. Despite the tragical fail of revolution in Germany, despite the two more attempts and then the decline because German workers' movement and Communist Party was so much under influence of the Soviet Union in the late 20s. So two attempts, one very grand, the years 1918-19 and then 1924, and the last one 1929, when the influence of Soviet Union was so strong as the revolution was not possible in Germany. But that period produced a lot of processes. So the same example as I mentioned with Schoenberg happened also with his pupil Hans Eisler. This movement and this education reappeared, was reinvented after First World War so strongly that he was able to get position in the Marxist workers' school at the end of the 20s, and he was employed as the professor, also leader of the workers' choirs and lecturer on the school in Berlin before the decline. German situation is very, very specific, and must be stressed that revolutionary process was by guilt, and it was really not fair, and it was in many, many cases pure propaganda, this fear of Bolshevism in Germany, because the story was totally different as in Soviet Union, and the position of their education process and the organization of the active masses was much more different, and such moves were possible, opening also spaces for other musics that were coming to those innovative people, as Eisler, for instance, is. That means a lot of cabaret music, new approaches, new wave of jazz already coming to Berlin in the 20s. And all this was in the shape that is much more and more strict, or more strict, documented for visual cultures, but somehow neglected in the musical field, where there are so many documents, but visualization was so much stronger that studies about, for instance, November Gruppe in visual arts or literature or Bauhaus are, or at least they seem, much more important than musical life in Berlin of the 20s, that is more or less in the common language positions into a cliché of some decay, of some scandals, of cabaret, etc. By the way, when mentioning cabaret, I think that while observing inventiveness and innovativeness in European music, one should make quite strong difference, and it's possible to think different developments in European continent while observing environment with strong cabaret tradition and environments with more varieté, with more variety conditions. And I'm strongly convinced that shape of music and thinking about music, or even thinking music in the environments with a strong cabaret, is in a way more fruitful and more productive than other parts where music is much more simply accepted as the part of entertainment, while cabaret tradition is much more open, also having space for other musical approaches going parallel at the same time. By the way, it's very interesting to approach avant-garde the amount of avant-garde and the question of appearance of different isms in the 20s, in the case I mentioned in the area, for instance, when Hans Eisler worked, when also himself was criticized as he is only doubling, in many cases, Bertolt Brecht's avant-garde approach, and that it's not productive to double it with another avant-garde composer while words are already avant-garde. Same problem appeared in the same time with Murnau, who proposed expressionistic German cinema. And in this avant-garde approach, he was himself strongly convinced that music to his films should not be expressionist as well, otherwise it's losing its tension and the whole meaning. So in many cases, directors and writers, like in the case of Murnau and Brecht, were choosing more so-called light music, more cabaret approach, what was the case in the collaboration with Brecht and Kurt Weill. Well, Eisler's position after the exile in United States was repositioned 20 years afterwards almost in the same way. When he was employed in the new GDR in the Eastern Germany, he took basically quite the same position as he had 20 years ago in the 1928, in the last part of the Marxist school in Berlin. Well, on the other hand, also in the case of Soviet Union, with a successful revolution that was realized against the will of people in 1917, at least the first 6-7 years, one may observe also this victory of visualization. So the fields of visual arts are much, much more in the presence of nowadays thinking about position of art in Soviet Union, while music also produced very fruitful moments, not only in the most famous way of inventing first electrophonic instruments, I mean the theremin, but also in some experiments that were quite parallel as those in Germany. That was parallel with the inventions and thinking in the Soviet case, strong experiments, how is it possible to make a total collective work, to put away conductor of the orchestra, experimenting with synesthesia, that means playing and having some kind of visual effects or light show during the 90s, inventing zvukofon, the huge machine that will connect theater, cinema, literature, music and everything into one big machine. All these processes that were and they could be observed also after the Second World War, so these things, innovative things in music approach were observed in Soviet Union also 50s and 60s, when there were enough materials in the history of synthetic sound in the Soviet Union. I suggest very good Austrian documentary Elektro Moskva, speaking about the history of how defense industry of Soviet Union was producing enough materials and the engineers in employed in the defense, in the army industry were able to produce synthetic sound of Soviet Union. Now Bogdan reminded me that it's nearly the end of it, and we are somewhere in the middle, so what to do? 10 minutes? Oh, it's... Oh, shit. Can I go briefly through the 60s?
Radio edit.
Yes. You are the editor. Edit me, please. Direct me. Okay. Well, it's possible to discuss more this revolutionary approach of the 20s and the influence of nowadays through all the shapes of innovativeness, and maybe the most closely connection with jazz, classical music, and other innovative principles that was possible in the 20s, especially in Germany. 60s, I mentioned as the crucial moment when the improvised music, for instance, as I mentioned at the beginning, was reborn. So it was new time of improvisation in European music history, this time freely improvised, either idiomatic or non-idiomatic, and for the observing the 60s, maybe this is most interesting part, and beside this lack that has no connection in this crack between contemporary classic and innovativeness on the other fields in free jazz, etc., that appeared in the 60s, has nothing to do anymore with the appearance in the golden 20s, when it was still possible to find together cabaret and more ernst, more serious principles in music. But on the other hand, it's also the there are other bonifications. We were also part of it in Yugoslavia, that was so-called Society of Culture. And when I mentioned the decline of German social democracy in the 60s and early 70s, we can speak about brilliant moment of, especially and not only, German social democracy. One may observe it also in Sweden, etc. So much, much more sources were possible to be given also in music field under this brief golden moment of social democracy in Europe, and also in Yugoslavia with its specific with a unique position, when sources for making things were possible to be given from many, many different fields, not only on the state level, on the city level, but also from the community level, from the syndicates, from the socialist youth, etc., etc. So this brief invention of Society of Culture is quite important, with, of course, totally different results all over the Europe. For the end of the era where musicians were in a way able to live as they played, until the dark neoliberalism attack in the mid-70s, for instance, from the era when it was possible to find finances, of course, Stockhausen, etc., people who were mentioned before were totally different class as all those who were innovative on other music fields. I would propose a reading chapter. For sure, some of you, if not all, probably know Chris Cutler, the drummer, percussionist extraordinaire, known from Henry Cow. Also good theoretician and co-inventor of rock in opposition movement, and the manager of the very good distribution called Recommended Records. In his book File Under Popular, where also other chapters are recommended, especially chapter about Sun Ra Orchestra and about the residents, and in general about the approach, about the meaning of approach to the source of production, about the meaning of how important is the ownership or access to the studio and studio principles. I suggest, as one of the best survey, is his chapter Progressive Music in the United Kingdom, when he is observing situation, and it's very special situation, and what was going on in the continent with observing British music was, as Cutler himself saw in the 70s, when he was so-called exile with the band Henry Cow on the continent. This myth about British music and this, let's say, total chauvinism, the United States and British chauvinism that he was observing on the continent, in his words, has nothing to do with reality from the mid-50s until the once more expected revolution in 1968. So he goes from the exception of rock and roll, of course, with a strong observation that rock and roll in the on the island was imported via opportunists. What meant in the mid-50s very strong youth movement against it, and by coincidence invention of the totally new music called skiffle that was using a lot of collective work and going into instrumental approaches that were totally different with the official story what happened with the rock and roll on another part of the Atlantic. Traditional jazz taken via blues with country moments, to say it briefly, and of course we remember the Shadows. Then Cutler goes to the early 60s, when underground was born with a strong black influence as the very special rhythm and blues, so he goes through the bands like Yardbirds, with another youth movements going to the mods and the bands like The Who. This is mid-60s, and what is most important in this chapter, when everybody was expecting a revolution, that socio-political moment in London was prepared for something revolutionary in music in 1968, actually nothing happened. You had all Che Guevara pictures, you had all memorabilia, all revolution was equipped on every corner, but it was kind of decline. Why? Because from the mid-60s until this so-called revolutionary year of 1968, everything happened before with the use of expressions like progressive and experimental also in the media. So Cutler's position is that revolution was made before, not in the year 68 itself. And this is one of the specifics that was totally neglected while observing British music on European continent, when they have the mythologies and they have urban legends about what is going on. Not only this, they also, through this approach, they somehow make connection with British and American approach that was not similar at all, especially if one observes psychedelic moment of intellectuals in this progressive times, 66 till 68, not only through Cream and the appearance of Jimi Hendrix, but especially, and Cutler makes a very nice comparison about early Pink Floyd with Syd Barrett and AMM ambitions on the field of other innovatives, while next year everything was done. So he was very unpleasantly surprised when with his band he had no more audience in the 70s, and in 74 they gave up and they went to the continent and continue their career in different ways, and very successful, but on the other hand a quite bitter way. These things and influences and stressing some specifics can be discussed also on the round table. I'm sorry, time is disappearing. We are about to find some new time for new words, for new people speaking, and I wish all the good luck to this community. Thank you.